Maybe it's because he's just a freshman who hasn't learned to shrug and give in. The first-term Republican assemblyman from Holbrook has taken on a great issue with great energy. The Navy vet and former city cop is trying to get Long Island a share of the bargain basement Niagara hydropower. He's been working on this for quite a long time. He's fearlessly confronted the state Senate's powerful energy chairman, and since he has drawn Governor Cuomo into the fray, the assemblyman is asking questions that only an Albany newbie would. This is per Ellis Hennigan from Newsday. And I have with me that person, Al Graff, New York State Assemblyman from the 5th District in Suffolk County. And to his left, Pete Olischuk, who's an advocate for Long Island environment and for power. So, Al, you've been working very hard at this. So what's going on?
Well, let me explain how this works. I lived upstate New York for a while. And there's a thing called preference power. And when it created the LIPA Act, Long Island was precluded from buying this preference power. And when I first got in office, and this is my second term right now, when I first got in office, I went to a meeting with LIPA, and they were discussing 15% of their cost, but they gave me a pie chart, and 62% of their cost was buying electricity. So 62% of their budget was purchasing electricity. They purchased the electricity from New York Power Authority. And what happened was, I'm looking at it, I'm saying, can you explain to me why in Lake Placid, which is in the Adirondacks, the cost of electricity is so cheap that everybody heats their house with electric baseboard heat. Now remember, in the Adirondacks, it goes below zero.
Mm-hmm.
Could you imagine heating your house on Long Island?
Nope.
With electric baseboard
I
heat?
I do.
Major no.
So
major
my question is, what are they doing right and you're doing wrong? Well, after asking many questions and getting, you know, driven around a circle, I focused them in and got the answers that I wanted. What happens is when we draw power out of the grid, we pay 9 cents per kilowatt. When Freeport, when Rockville Center, Greenport, and Lake Placid draw power out of the grid, they're only paying 1 cent per kilowatt.
Wow.
But that's because they're generating their own?
No.
No?
All the power gets pulled out of the grid. But the thing is, we get charged 9 cents, while other areas get charged 1 cent. Let me explain why this is important. Long Island, when you look at property taxes, you know, that, and how much we pay in property taxes, and how we have our children moving away, our friends, our neighbors, our family moving away, and our senior citizens moving away because they can't afford to live here. Well, it's affected by the cost of electricity, our property tax. Let me tell you why. Islip, the town of Islip, their monthly electric bill is like $330,000 a month.
Hmm.
Brookhaven, $450,000 a month. Sachem School District, $240,000 a month.
Well, that seems high.
Right?
That's just a district.
You want to take a guess for Suffolk County government? $1,779,000 a month.
A month.
These are your property taxes, right? Not to mention businesses or the homeowners, right? If I could even get the cost of power down to 6 cents per kilowatt, think about your home electric bill. If I can cut your home electric bill by a third, right?
Makes
what
it,
effect would that have
makes
on your
a difference,
budget?
Sure. Makes
right?
a difference, sure.
So, I mean, this is a very important issue.
Yeah, people talk all the time about not being able to have their kids stay here because the cost of either real estate or property taxes or energy costs are so high. Even now with the cost of gas on top of that,
right.
Nobody can afford it.
Well, when I was out, when I'm knocking on doors, I'm talking to people, I talk to a lot of senior citizens. And what they tell me is that they see their grandchildren, or their grandchildren are living in other states. And they talk to their grandchildren once a month on the phone, if they're lucky. That they see their grandchildren once a year, if they're lucky. You know, I grew up, I had my grandparents were part of my life. My grandparents had an influence on who I became as an adult. And I find it sad that, you know, our kids aren't
sure,
getting the same experience.
Yeah.
So my main focus has been to try to cut costs so that people can afford, or especially my children, I don't want to visit one kid in Florida, another kid in Georgia, another kid in whatever other
Which state. Is happening all over the place.
Right. Yeah. I want my grandchildren and my children around my Thanksgiving Day table, right?
Yeah.
Or during Christmas and the holidays or whatever holidays.
Yeah, who would have thought that you'd have your kids and they'd be living in a different place?
Yeah, I want them around.
Sure.
And
yeah.
The way to do that is to look to cut costs for, you know, other governments and stuff. So, and electricity is so important. It affects our economy in so many ways. If we can cut the costs for school districts, for town governments, for county governments, not to mention the non-for-profits that are out there, right? And businesses. You
why
want to create
why were
jobs.
We paying it here in Long Island? Why were we paying some of that cost for the hydropower?
Well,
up there?
What happened is when they created LIPA, there's actually a clause in the LIPA Act that prevents us from buying this preference power, the 1 cent per kilowatt power. Mm. And I actually put in legislation to repeal that section of the LIPA Act. So we have a long way to go, but now other issues have come up with LIPA due to Hurricane Sandy. And the governor now is proposing that we sell LIPA to a private company. Well, we saw that.
The governor's proposing?
The governor's proposing. Mm-hmm. Well, we have seen that movie before. It was called Lilco. That didn't work out too well for us. So a lot of the legislators have spoken up about this. Excuse me. And one of the things I said was when we deregulated the telephone company, right, you had a choice of different telephone companies that could compete to provide you your telephone service. Why don't we look at this as far as power is concerned?
Create competition.
Create competition. The other thing, too, is the hydropower that you refer to, or really the preference power. Who is able to get that power is municipal electric companies. They buy the power at 1 cent per kilowatt. So should we be looking at breaking it up into smaller municipal electric companies where they can get that preference power?
And we would be one of those?
And well, we could,
be
one of those. Yeah. I mean, do we want to do it as a Nassau County and a Suffolk County municipal electric? Or do you want to do a town municipal electric? A lot of people say, oh, we don't want municipal electric government. Let me tell you something. Lake Placid has had a municipal electric company for a long time, and it works very well.
Why can't we combine Nassau and Suffolk? Make it a Long Island
well,
enterprise?
Well, you do have that. It's called, right now?
It's called
LIPA.
LIPA, yeah.
How's that working out for you? You know?
The question would be then, if that sounds like the ideal way to go in the long run, the municipal ones, but the storm proved to us that LIPA isn't just the company that's providing us power. They're also, I'm going to change the statement, say, is the company that failed to provide the maintenance needed to keep the grid working. If it becomes municipal power, how does the grid get maintained, the
well,
service?
LIPA actually contracted that out,
mm-hmm.
Okay? And National Grid was the one that was doing it. And to be honest with you, during the hurricane, I know I was in my office every day. We were working on trying to get power restored. And LIPA was calling these meetings. And after a while, we weren't even paying attention to LIPA.
Mm-hmm.
We weren't, because they weren't doing anything.
Right.
And National Grid, the governor actually had National Grid take it over. And once National Grid took over restoration and we got LIPA out of the way, we really got things moving, believe it or not. So, I mean, if you look at it, right now, LIPA is not accountable to anyone. They're not accountable.
Right.
Right? You can't fire them.
Mm-hmm.
Right? But with a municipal electric, if it's run by a local municipality, mm-hmm. and you have the nightmares that we had with LIPA, then what happens is,
you can go to a closest.
You can vote out the local person.
The closest source, right?
To see if you can do it a different way. Look, what we're doing now is not working.
Okay?
So we have to figure out a way to be able to produce and to buy and to distribute cheaper electricity.
So ultimately, your suggestion is that we break down or locally organize a buying.
Well, the governor rushed on this like he did the gun bill. Okay? He just wanted to get it through quick. And we were able to go on the press and go, slow down here. let's not do this. Let's get some public input on this so we can look at and see what's the best for the people of Long Island, right, as far as securing cheaper power. Because, look, it's the driving factor of everything on the island.
What are your people saying, the people that you've talked to? Well, what's the consensus? Is it just simply economics, or is it also the protection they think they might need from a storm or something? What's their motivation?
Well, I think right now what people are looking at as far as electricity is concerned, they're not happy with how LIPA performed. They're not happy with the bills that they get every month on electricity. And they're looking for something different. So, I mean, look, there's a lot of discussion that has to be had on the right way to go.
This is not going to happen overnight. It's not going to happen overnight, right?
To make a split decision on what to do about LIPA without any discussion, I just don't think that's the way to go. And we've kind of put the brakes on the governor here.
Well, that's good.
The question I have, though, is we're talking 1 cent to 5 cents. It's a big difference.
It's 1 cent to 9 cents.
To 9 cents, excuse me. That's even better, because it sounds to me, after you gave me the county figure, it's almost a patch to the county deficit in a very short time, or the Brookhaven town deficits. Right. So there's red ink going on top of red ink everywhere, getting worse and worse. But the people are paying their electric bills. LIPA is getting this money. What is all this surplus money doing? Where is it going? What it's paying for something. What is it paying for? Because it's clearly not paying for anything here. We have wires hanging from tree to tree just about, falling down all over the place. Nothing is getting repaired properly. Nobody's thinking in terms of getting a more secure distribution system.
My initial reaction is not to go after somebody after the storm hits, because, you know, there's going to be lots of that was my
Cuomo's
initial reaction.
Hitting this thing like a hurricane.
Where's
too.
The real issue? Is it just in damage control? Is it repairing the lines? Is it ineffective readiness? You know, what was the real issue?
There's two different issues there. And the surplus money, unfortunately, is a lot of this was mismanaged. And what's happening is, like, we had the debt for sure that was forced upon us. And how LIPA paid that debt was they borrowed money to pay the debt, and we created new debt. Mm-hmm. So all we did was shift it.
Yeah.
Okay? As far as the underground, you know, putting wires underground, which is important. I lived upstate for a while, and I lived through the ice storm. And what happened with the ice storm is the trees took the power lines down. And in Sandy here, most of the power outages were the trees taking down or the
taking
poles
down the wires.
Cracking.
Yeah.
And what they're saying is that it's too expensive to bury the lines. I just wrote a piece of legislation, and I looked at it. And after 9/11, the federal government, some of the money that they put aside, and in our case, the FEMA money that they have for mitigation purposes. And what they did was they wanted to hire more police officers. So municipalities that hired police officers were reimbursed the police officers' salaries and for their benefits, okay, by this pool of money. So I wrote a piece of legislation where what we can do is put aside a pool of money and reach out to the towns, the counties, and the villages. And what we would do is this pool of money, if they give us two people with a backhoe, two employees with a backhoe, we can reimburse them for the salaries, for the benefits, and for the use of the backhoe. And then they work with the electric companies to put the power on the line.
These are new people?
Ground.
New people employed?
No. These are people that are employed now.
Okay.
Understand, if we bid this out, you know it's going to an out-of-state company.
Mm.
Okay? And it's going to create out-of-state jobs. So at a time where our counties, our towns, and our villages are laying off people, right? This is a way
to keep local
people employed, and it's the most cost-effective way to get the power lines on the ground.
The pay structure stays the same, and the work is now being done.
And you have the maintenance system in place, too.
And understand that how much cost it is for us when we have to deal with the broken poles, the down power lines, right, and all of those other
problems. What are the costs for those repairs during these storms versus the work that you're intending that these people do?
Right. So we're taking a look at it now, and Senator Mazioz, who we mentioned before, he is the chairman for the Energy Committee. So I gave him a copy of the bill. He's interested. He's taking a look at it now. But you got to understand, New York State is the most partisan place you've ever seen in the world. And you have to learn the rules.
I've been at that for 25 years. I know some of these.
And you have to have a Republican to sponsor a bill in the Senate. And you have to have a Democrat sponsor the bill in the Assembly.
Right.
But what I've done since I've been there is there's an old saying that I love by Harry Truman. And what it says, it's amazing how much you can get done if you don't care who gets the credit.
Right.
So with this piece of legislation, what I do is I'll get the Republican sponsor in the Senate, and I'll hand it off to a Democratic colleague in the Assembly,
right,
just to see that the legislation gets passed,
yeah,
because that's more important to me than having, you have to learn in this job, especially if you're in a minority, to put your ego aside, leave it at the door, and just do what you think is right.
Sure, we tried that at the shared parenting bill. We passed the, right? Democratic sponsors for the shared parenting bill. We'd always get the conservatives or the Republicans to go along with the shared parenting bill. We could never get the Democrats to go along with it. I'm sorry, Pete.
That's okay. It sounds like the legislation you're proposing is something that really needs to get moved quickly. And unfortunately, we went through Sandy.
Not going to happen quickly.
We went through Sandy, and then came Nemo, and now comes Cuomo. Yeah. And it's a reaction like a storm that's just out there to destroy LIPA or whatever it is. And like you said, we've been there before. We've seen the show. My concern is, at this point, unfortunately, as fast as the gun law went through, that the wrong decision isn't made too quickly. What can we, as public advocates, that basically are grassroots out there in the streets, do and tell our people, your people?
Yeah, that's a good question. We'd like to help if we can.
Help.
Yeah.
To make sure that, one, that it's reacted to much faster, as it's clearly needed after these two storms, but that it's thought out well and in a direction that's in the best interest of the community, the people, the cost, and truthfully, to start saving some municipal, county governments in their funding problems, because all we're doing is getting a reciprocal effect of losing more services.
You know, putting the words fast and government together in a sentence sometimes
not going to work.
You know, I think the scariest language, the scariest words in the English language is, I'm from the government, I'm here to help.
Yeah.
You know? So, look, what I'm saying is, let's take our time and do it right. Because when you do things quickly, one, it never works out. Mm-hmm. And two, it winds up costing you more money. So let's do it right the first time. Let's have discussion. Let's have people have their say. It just feels like lately in New York State, they don't want opposing opinions lately, especially when they're pushing legislation through.
Right.
What I found, I was a town supervisor. What I found is when I tried to write a piece of legislation and I wound up with input from other people, I always wound up with a stronger piece of legislation, or a stronger proposal, or a stronger program. We shouldn't be afraid of hearing other people's opinions.
Sure, you can't know it all.
That's how government works.
You can't know it all. You need help and support from wherever you can get it.
Right. So, I mean, right now, and that's the biggest thing, they're pushing these bills through quickly. I mean, if you don't mind me going off the topic, another bill that he's pushing through that is just horrific is, and it sounds nice, it's called the Reproductive Rights Act. But you could be the most pro-choice person in the world and you won't agree with this bill. Because what this bill says is that the definition of a live birth is a baby out of the womb with no medical assistance.
That's further along than what it used to be when Roe v. Wade was passed.
Well, think about this. We have great success with preemie babies. So under this bill, I can have a preemie baby in an incubator with maybe a feeding tube. The arms are moving, the legs are moving.
It's alive.
The eyes are open, they're crying, they're aware of the surroundings. But according to that definition, I could walk over to that incubator, pick that baby up, snap its neck, and all I'm doing is a late-term abortion.
Yeah, partial birth abortion.
I don't think anyone would agree with that definition. Mm. So
we were all upset when we heard about the trimester pregnancies being aborted, when people were going in that sixth and a half month, and so.
Well,
but
you know what?
Really,
ACLU pushed this bill. They came into my office and discussed it, and I went through all of this with them, and they had a year to try to make. They didn't even attempt to make changes, and the governor right away is now trying to push this bill out here.
Yeah.
That's just one bill.
Yeah, talk about the slippery slope from where we went to that level. My God, yeah.
And the other thing is the minimum wage bill now. They're talking about moving
bucks,
up to $9 an hour, and what this is supposed to do is protect families. You know,
it's going to cause more unemployment in the long run.
Well, hold on. It's supposed to protect, you know, to try to help these families out. But what happens is the families that are making it, the present wage, they get New York Healthcare Plus, they get all these other benefits. And if you put them at $9 an hour, right, then they're above the level to get these programs.
Hmm.
So basically, they get a couple more pennies, right, an hour, where after you figure out the taxes and stuff, but they lose their health care benefits, they lose all of these other benefits.
They're off the cliff.
So basically you're giving them a dollar raise.
Perception is
you're
going to do better.
You know,
yeah.
You're taking $10 away from them. So you're actually going to put these people in a worse position.
That's right, slight
by
hand.
Increasing this. And the other thing is summer employment for your college students, right? That's going to evaporate in a lot of places. You're going to cost people their jobs. You're going to cost people their health insurance coverage they have and other assistance they have, right? So sometimes you try to figure out what they're trying to accomplish, and it never happens.
No, it doesn't seem right. The families on this, I'm most concerned about, because we're primarily family-oriented program.
Right.
We do, you know, issues of divorce and trying to save families and things like that, are under tremendous pressure now, more so than, I don't know, than I can ever remember. Costs of everything have gone up, fuel, power, as we're talking about now. And now they're also leaving. States that have better incentives, like Texas has better business incentives, is trying to draft companies from California. Florida, with the lower tax rate, is trying to draft people from New York. Do you see this happening? This is happening now, and a little bit, it's picking up steam, that other states are trying to do something to get people to come to their state.
Well, you know what, you can't go to your, I think, you know, the governor's favorite saying is New York open for business. I think it should say New York is open for business except Long Island. Because unless we deal with the cost of power, how do you expect to grow our economy?
You're not gonna make it an entertaining place to go, sure.
I mean, how are you going to get manufacturing here?
Yeah.
All right.
And manufacturers already left Long Island.
With electricity costs where they are. Okay. With the school taxes, and in part because of the cost of electricity. How are you going to grow our economy, right, unless you deal with the cost of electricity? How are you going to grow jobs?
This subject was brought up years ago, you know, many years ago, many times, and we never seem to do anything about it. Is that because the climate up in Albany is such that it doesn't change? It hasn't changed in these areas and doesn't want to change?
Look, I'm going to go back to my statement from before. You've heard of a New York Minute?
Yeah.
They're governing by New York sound bites. Okay,
well,
what sounds good in the news? Okay.
Yeah, right.
And, you know, there are...
We try to be responsible media here. I know what you're talking
right.
about. Yeah.
You know, I'm happy because I'm finding a lot of my programs that I've done on my own have wound up in the governor's state of the state. Like the Super Energy Highway is talking about trying to get that cheaper power, that hydropower down here, right? So
is
I was
that
excited
that
about
that.
Is
that on-ramp you were talking about? Is that on-ramp thing?
Well, what happened is originally when he wrote it, we weren't included. Okay, it stopped at New York City.
Yeah, that's what I heard, yeah.
So what I did is online petitions to push this forward. It's still up there, pluglongislandin.com. And what I said is Long Island wants its on-ramp to the governor's new super energy right. highway. But you know what? It seems like we're long on promises and short on on actions, because I was looking today, and now he's talking about a new tap. We have a new Tappan Zee Bridge that I keep hearing about. I right. keep driving over the old Tappan Zee Bridge on my way to Albany.
Maybe you're looking right, it's on the left yeah. side maybe?
But I guess the new energy highway is going to go over that new Tappan Zee Bridge that I haven't seen yet. So, I mean, it's time for the governor to stop making promises. Let's start getting things going and let's actually perform here. So, but there are other things that, I mean, there's other legislation that I've been opposed to. But the one thing, if for a lighter note, I can say that sometimes Albany is a very comical place, especially when you see the bills coming out of New York City. There was actually a bill, and I'm on the Codes Committee, so I
On what committee?
The Codes
Committee. Oh, Codes, yeah. Mm-hmm.
This is the laws and stuff. And there was actually a bill that said that barbers who sold alcohol to underage minors would lose their barber's license. And I looked at it and I go, wait a minute. Are we talking about the people that cut your hair? And they looked at me and they said, well, yes. I go, is this a prevalent problem throughout the state that I'm unaware of? And the chairman looks and goes, apparently I have a bill on it.
Jeez, yeah.
And I looked at it and I said, well, that would explain a lot of the haircuts that I see out there, you know?
You know, we have an awful lot of old, antiquated bills that are in the system that really should.
Oh, these are new bills.
Much. You're kidding me.
No, this was another one that said, I love this one. Children 12 years old and under could not sit in the front seat of a car. Okay, you see where they're going with this. But I looked at him and I said, but there's an exception in this bill, isn't that true? And they looked and they go, yeah. And I go, and isn't it true? Under this bill, a kid 12 years old and under can sit in the front seat of a car if the back seat is filled with adults. And they looked and they go, yeah. I go, well, that's just stupid.
Something's wrong with the language there. No,
but understand, like yes. I said, quick, yeah. Government shouldn't be used in the same sentence.
Let me ask a question.
I'm afraid we ran out of time.
Yet. Okay, just real quickly.
Go ahead, quick.
Because there's a lot of money that's disappearing someplace. Following the money, is there someone that is receiving an incentive to prevent this type of legislation from moving forward fast?
No, I don't think so. You know,
Make it quick, Chief.
I'm not good with the conspiracies.
Okay.
You know, that's why we have a controller. And the controller's been looking at the governor's budget. He's not too happy in certain areas either.
Thank you, Assemblyman Al Graff. I appreciate that. And Peter Olszewski, thank you very much. Societal and political trends are rapidly breaking down the family that once was the cornerstone of our great American culture. FIT, we know you cannot get this information on your own, so we'll bring it to your TV, of course, every single week. My name is Chris DiMaggio. Thank you for watching FIT TV, and we'll see you again next week.